أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We are talking about hadith, and last week I explained to you that the word is mentioned in many places in the Holy Quran, and the fact that its basic meaning might be taken to be something new as opposed to something that is old. And then moving on from that, we have something called ilme hadith, which in many instances is translated as science of hadith. And because of this confusion with science as we understand it, like physics and chemistry and biology, it's not science in that sense in a way, I've said the subject of hadith. We have physics as a subject and so on and so forth. But in Arabic it's called ilme hadith. I suppose it's called science, because one reason for that is that just as in science, everything is investigated and researched and so on until we get to a conclusion. The reason for calling hadith or ilme hadith, translating that as science of hadith, is this, that those who compiled these books of hadith, they went through a lot of research and investigation and so on and so forth to try and see whether a hadith was authentic or not. So ilme hadith, its definition is, I suppose, investigating or researching any topic, any saying, anything which has something to do with the life of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, his sayings, his traditions, etc., etc. Now, having said that, we immediately come to what you might think is a contradiction. Because if you look at books of hadith, you don't just find sayings of the Holy Prophet and actions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, but also sayings of his companions, sayings of the next generation who came after the companions, the Tabaeen, and what's called Taba Tabaeen, even the next generation, the generation after that. Now the question is it right? Some people say, well, hadith should be restricted to what the Holy Prophet Muhammad said and did and so on, and not his companions or those that came after the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But those who included what the companions of the Holy Prophet did and said had a very good reason. And the reason they gave was this. They said these people reflected the character and the morals and the actions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad. They did or tried to do exactly what the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. You remember our Imam Hami Sahib related an incident that Hazrat Umar, on his way back from Makkah to Medina, stopped his camel at one place, and he got off the camel and sat down as if he had a call of nature, and he hadn't. And then he, on his way back, he did exactly the same thing, and his companion was puzzled by this. Another Umar, I think at that time he was the Khalifa, so his companion asked him, why did he do that? And he said, it's because I saw the Holy Prophet stop here for this purpose. And he would just trying to emulate the example of Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these people went to these lengths. There was, in fact, his son Ibn Umar, all through his life, whatever he did, first thing he would ask was, what did the Holy Prophet do? Did he say anything about this? And then, having found that out, he would try and do exactly that. So the argument that these people, who included the saints of the companions of the Holy Prophet, radiallahu ta'ala anhum, and even those who followed them, was that these people actively tried to copy the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if they have said something, if they have done something, they must have seen or heard the Holy Prophet do it. And it may not be in the books of, or it may not come down to us as having the Holy Prophet having done it, but he must have, because these people did it. So they should be included in the books of Hadith. But talking about Hadiths, we then have other things. We have the technical terms. We have, one thing is commonly known, and that is Sunnah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad. But there are other words used as well, such as Khabar and Asar and so on and so forth. And a lot of people place great store by these terms and so on. But we must remember one thing, and that is, however great the efforts to compile a hadith and so on were, this subject, this science, didn't actually come into being until much after the passing away of the Holy Prophet Muhammad. These words, these technical terms, these classifications and so on, they weren't done for the convenience of the companions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad. They were done for our convenience. I want to find out about Hazrat Umar or Hazrat Abu Bakr. Well, I go to a book and there I find what the Holy Prophet said about them. You know, these people were like this. So all this categorization, and the sad thing is that this categorization and these technical things seem to have taken precedence above the spirit of what the Holy Prophet was trying to say. So what developed as historical research, and one reason for that historical research was that Muslims who came later said, you know, I don't know anyone who saw the Holy Prophet. How do I know how to behave? How do I know what the Holy Prophet ﷺ would have done in this situation? So these great scholars and so on, they said, okay, what we'll do is we'll gather together all the information. And, I mean, obviously, you know, take a book. If it's not characterized by chapters and topics and so on, and, you know, one hadith is about telling the truth, the other one's about how to say, do the wuzu, another one is about how to say the azan, another one is about the Holy Prophet's opinion of Hazrat Umar and so on. If you want to find something, you'll have to go through the whole 2,000-page book. But the important thing to remember, and people forget this, is that all of this technical analysis and so on came later. And that was to make it easy for us and people like us to sort of, you know, try and follow the Holy Prophet's sayings and actions. But we must look at the spirit of these things. And I'll end by giving you an example. But if you're not careful, how you can get into error. Qadiani Jamaat often quotes what they call a hadith. Well, it's not a hadith for two reasons. It is a hadith because under the definition that whatever a companion of the Holy Prophet said could be regarded as a hadith. It is said that Hazrat Aisha made this statement. But it's not a hadith in the sense that it's not found in the books of hadith or anything like that. So unless you are aware of this difference between books of hadith and so on, you will be misled into thinking that it's in a book of hadith. And the saying is that say Khatmun Nabiyyin, but don't say La Nabiyya Ba'd. So say Khatmun Nabiyyin, but don't say the last of the prophets. And they say, look, you know, this proves that prophets can come after the Holy Prophet Muhammad. And that amuses me, because the person upon whom this verse was revealed, that is the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was asked, what's the meaning of Khatmun Nabiyyin? He said, La Nabiyya Ba'di. So surely, the person who received the revelation is in a better position to know what the revelation means than even someone as illustrious as Hazrat Aisha. So, I will end here today. I think next week what I'll try and do is go through some of the rules that compilers and collectors of the hadith devised when to check the authenticity of a hadith and how they applied them. And you can see how these books came about.